Do you fear death?
As a natural man, certainly, yes, certainly. Absolutely, because we are not yet, we have not reached the stage of sainthood. We've all read the lives of many, many saints. We have some idea of what they're like. And it is, in my belief, only in a high level of sainthood that the fear of death is transcended. It's not a simple thing. And ordinary Christian faith is wonderful, and it's a sine qua non. We need it, otherwise we have nothing. But it doesn't instantly elevate us to great spiritual heights. It's something that you have to work on a lifetime. And there are millions and millions of Christians of all denominations and grades, but only a handful in every generation reaches the level of true sainthood. And this is something, it's not a matter of degree, it's a matter of kind. It isn't that we have a numerical scale and then we say, above this number, it's sainthood. No, because sainthood is something generically different from the ordinary condition of man. And incidentally, sainthood is rare. And in my life, I have met only one person who is bona fide a saint. And he is as much different from any other person I've ever met in the world. It's almost as if he were a different species. So many Christians, I think, have somewhat inadequate ideas of what makes a saint. A saint isn't simply somebody who is very, very good and lives a very, very good life. He is that, but that's not what makes him a saint. What makes him a sainthood is categorically different from the state, from our ordinary state. And saints come in all shapes and guises and many different kinds of life they've lived. The saint that I had the privilege to see, I visited him. He has since been canonized, and his name is Saint Padre Pio of Pietrelcina. Now, anyhow, he was a Capuchin monk. He spent his life in a monastery, San Giovanni Rotondo, in southern Italy. And the most remarkable thing about him was that when he was a young priest, on a certain Friday, he said Mass, and while he was saying Mass, he experienced great pain, and at the end of Mass, he noticed that he had the so-called stigmata, that is the wounds of Christ, five wounds, two in the hands, two in the feet, and one. So these five wounds of Christ were manifest in his body. This is called the stigmata. So he was the first priest in history who received the stigmata. And he received it at an early age, I think he was in his 20s. And these stigmata remained on him for 50 years. They came on a Friday and they left on a Friday. And 2 days after the stigmata disappeared from his body, he died. So it was evidently his mission, so to speak, to suffer. And he suffered terribly. That was his mission. So it is so difficult for a non-Christian to understand all this because it is so contrary to our normal human way of looking at things and what we desire and what we shun. So I'm saying all these things just to make the point that sainthood is a very real thing. It's a very wonderful thing. It is almost always associated with great pain and suffering, preceding the miracle of sainthood, and oftentimes also after that miracle has occurred. So a saint is someone who, as it were, in some minuscule way, repeats the life of Christ in his own body, and they're all grades. And so the example of Padre Pio, which I mentioned, it's a very extreme example, but that's why it is helpful in our attempt to understand what sanctity is. It's a very real thing, and it's a discontinuity. In other words, in our ordinary state, we're far, far from sainthood. We can't even imagine it, much less live as saints live. But we can understand, we can appreciate what sanctity is. It is becoming somewhat, in some minuscule way, like Christ. It is always associated with suffering. You do not attain any higher spiritual grade just in fun. No, it's very very serious business. And pain and suffering, as I say, is somehow a sine qua non in this man's journey to God. Many people, and I think there are also many people who call themselves Christian and think they are a Christian, who do not really accept this fact, because it goes so much against our human desire. We don't want to suffer. And for example, if you practice certain abstinence during Lent or so, we as human beings, we do it sort of reluctantly. It goes against our grain. And that is exactly why it is spiritually efficacious, because religion is to go against that natural grain.
What's next for you?
What's next for me, my friend, is to prepare myself to enter into the life beyond this one, to enter into the next phase of life. Christianity and every true religion has always taught that one should prepare oneself for the end. One of the great insights from the Vedic tradition is the Vedic tradition declares that the natural life of man divides into four stages. Brahmacharya, this is where a young man prepares himself to enter life through study. He's expected to live a celibate life. It's a sort of an ascetic life. And next comes grihastya, the life of married life. So the man marries, he founds a family, and he has an employment, and he supports his family. This is the second stage of life, according to the Vedic tradition. The third stage is, I think they call it vanaprastha. I think it means a forest life. The idea is that the children are grown up and they've married themselves. So the man and his wife enter a new stage of life, which is a life of, they call it forest life, because it's a very simple life, It involves little outward activity. It's a matter of preparing for the life to come. And then the fourth stage of life is called sannyas. And this is something very Vedic, is foreign to our Western way of thinking. But according to the Vedic tradition, this is when both the man and the woman leave all attachment to the world and totally fix their spirit upon God. So the extreme way of living that life of sannyas, and this is actually, I saw people living like that. It was still going on. You retire completely from the world, and you give your whole day to prayer and contemplation. Very few people in the Western world can even conceive of such a thing. When I was traveling in India half a century ago, it was still visible. It was rare, yes. And you had to go far away from New Delhi and Calcutta and any place where the Western world has so much as touched, because the Western world is poison in that regard. So this is the ancient Vedic culture. We can't duplicate it here, but I'm just mentioning that the principle applies to us too. The principle is that at the end of our life, there should be a transitional phase where we turn our attention away from the world and the cares of the world, and we live a life as much as possible in prayer, solitude, contemplation. I think the principle is there for everyone. Everyone will do so to the extent that he or she can. And actually, from a higher point of view, all the earlier phases of our life should really, in truth, be a preparation for that fourth stage, which is itself a preparation for the true life, which is life eternal. So, but I think only someone who can really be called a saint is able to, in a very real way, live up to these ideals. But I think even so, we should know these ideals and try to live up to it as we can. I think God in His mercy will accept this.
Thank you so much, Wolfgang. Thank you.
Well, I thank you, Curt. I regard it as a great privilege to meet you, to spend a few days getting to know each other, and I wish you all that is good. I think your apostolate, and that's the right word, it is an apostolate that you have. Your apostolate is a very noble, very important apostolate, because what the world needs today, almost more than anything else, is the kind of thing that you are attempting to bring about. For example, the understanding of our great traditions, the understanding of why we are really in deep trouble today. It takes a certain spiritual eye to see that. Not everybody does. And in fact, the more you are associated with universities and other contemporary institutions, the more you are drawn into the very opposite. So your apostolate is so important. You are in the service of God, in the service of religion, and there's nothing greater than that. Nothing.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.